subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates. Hello and welcome to the Print Interviews. We are coming to you from Leh in Ladakh and we're getting you all the latest updates from the conflict here in the Galwan Valley in eastern Ladakh. And today I'm being joined with retired Colonel Sonam Wangchuk, who's also Mahavir Chakra. He has served in the 1999 Kargil War, and today he's joining us to give his perspective on what really is happening at the line of actual control and what are the options that we have at this point of time. Welcome, Colonel, to the print. My first question to you, sir, is that in view of the latest developments that have been happening, we've been hearing a lot of contradicting versions about the Chinese, that they have come to finger four, they have occupied that territory, and there's de-escalation process has allegedly started in the past 2 days. So what are the options that India has militarily at this point of time?
Militarily, as you're saying, you know, we are building up. Things have been, they are being taken care of, like the three services. They are in synergy, and I think strategy is being worked out. So that is what, at the level of the chief, can do. He has to be prepared for any kind of, you know, contingency which might arise. But at the same time, I suppose it is the political will which is going to dictate what the army is going to do or what the armed forces of the country, they will be in a position to do. You know, you can't be taking independent decisions because in our country, basically, the army, it has been always apolitical. It has, gone by the will of the country, and they have listened to the government, because finally government is the voice of the nation. They are the representatives whom people they've chosen. So I think army understands that, and whatever action army takes, I think it is in the entire interest of the nation. As of now, we are preparing. That's what you see, you know, in case you see the Air Force, in case you see the Army, they are prepared. The kind of force level which is required, they are being built up in this area. And I can only say that, you know, rest, you know, it the intricate and detailed, you know, plans of the Army, that only the people who are serving, they will know. And that also, as I've been saying, it is the information percolates down at a need-to-know basis. Normally, army, you know, the junior level officers, they won't. They are only fed that much of information which is required in order to carry out the missions. That's about all. Because the vision, the larger picture, that is always, you know, with the senior officers, starting from the chief of the army staff and the other counterparts, Navy and Air Force.
Sir, just a couple of days back, we saw that that the government has given the army full free hand to do as they will at the line of actual control. Yeah. So do you think that this is a good move? Do you think this is an unprecedented move as well? Or has this happened in the past that the army has been given a completely free hand to deal with the situation as it evolves?
Yeah, actually, you know, this sort of a situation has never arisen. You would see this sort of a, you know, crisis situation with China. I think it is unprecedented. After 62, we have been having, you know, certain skirmishes where both the armies, they have come face to face, but finally it has been resolved, and the Chinese army, they have withdrawn. I would say better sense has prevailed on both the sides. But this time, I think it is slightly more prolonged, and you know, that incident of 15th and 16th, that was very bad. And wherein we lost a colonel, the commanding officer of a unit 16 Bihar, and there were a number of other casualties also. So seeing from that point of view, I think the situation has become slightly more grave and more serious. And that is why I've been saying, you know, all the channels, all our options that we have, that has got to be open. Mm-hmm. As of now, the senior army officers, the local commanders, at the level of the political leadership, they have to engage. They have to engage in a dialogue. And I think, let's hope, you know, China sees sense.
So also, just a couple of days back, Times of India, in fact, had reported that Harinder Singh, Lieutenant General, who's actually leading the who led the talks, 10-hour-long talks with the Chinese a couple of days back. He said that the Chinese need to move away from our territory. Now that is in complete contradiction to what the local leaders that I spoke to over here, Mr. Gyal P. Wangyal, who's the Ladakh Hill Development Council chairman, he said that there has been no incursion. So there are a lot of contradicting versions coming in. The first time, army saying something, political leadership is saying something. Is that giving a wrong kind of messaging to the people of the country as well as to what is happening? And will that affect the morale of the forces, sir?
We can't, you know, the media, the local people generally, the versions that have been coming from the public, you know, that speaks for the entire, I think, region and people over here. And I also, being a part of public, you know, we are aware Galwan skirmishes have taken place. And Pengongso also, media has been saying that Chinese, they have built up. So you can't be denying those facts. And I think there was a clarification from the, you know, government side also. I think they have spoken initially. The Prime Minister, he had given a statement saying nobody has come into our area and no post has been taken. But I think at a later stage, things have been clarified. And we have been told the incursions that had taken place after the incident of 15th and 16th, these people, they've been driven out. And I have seen from the media, you know, certain sources saying the later part of the brawls which had taken place, they had taken place in the territory of China. So the commanding officer of 16 Bihar, he had ensured, he had, I think, given his life also. He had sacrificed his life. There were so many other, you know, jawans also who had that sense not to, you know, have this brawl in our territory, because in case we have negotiations thereafter, then these people, they don't have any reason to move out. So that is why I think most probably they had taken the initiative. They had, you know, done this sort of a thing.
But what about this mixed messaging? What effect does it have on the morale of the forces? There's one side, we are being told that there has been no incursion. Then there's a clarification. Then there's another statement coming in that they are moving out from our territory. So in that situation, our forces who are standing at the border and they are fighting in a terrain that is so difficult. What does it do to them if we can't even if we don't even acknowledge what they are doing?
That I feel as of now, you know, the forces, they always remain insulated from these kinds of, you know, talks which are happening. You can say rumors also, many a number of times. So we try and insulate our troops. We have, you know, our system of keeping the morale of the troops high. The company commanders, the junior leaders, they keep on speaking to the troops. And it may not be necessary every time, you know, you have to know the mind of the government or the nation. Because we, as people who are in uniform, we know what our responsibility is. It may be a prolonged affair. Maybe a short affair, but then, you know, mentally you are always prepared. So we are trained for this sort of a contingency, and I think the soldier, he is very strong. So he is not going to be moved by, for him, you know, these superficial circumstances, because in case there is an enemy, he knows he has to focus on the task. And I think that is more important, you know, focusing on the task, seeing, you know, what lies ahead, and thereafter planning accordingly.
You spoke about the Bihar regiment, sir. So there's been a lot of talk about how the Bihar regiment has been fighting in Ladakh for the past couple of years, but there should be a concerted need to bring in locals in this area, to send them to the border at LAC, because they are more attuned to the terrain over here. Do you think that is part of the problem that we are facing, that our deployment also needs to take into account the kind of terrain that is there, and the kind of soldiers who are more used to, not that the Bihar regiment is not capable, but the locals are more, they have lived here all their lives, so they might be be a little more attuned to acclimatizing. Do you think that is also a part of the problem, sir?
Yeah, I won't say that it's a part of the problem, but I think, in case you do that, we are going in the right direction. I think the locals, they have to be, involved. And as far as seeing from the army point of view, I think definitely the Ladakh Scouts, they don't have any problems of adaptation. They are totally, acclimatized to this place and they're staying here. And it's in their, physiology, these mountains, they are not much of a problem for them because from the childhood, these people, they've been, playing in the mountains. So therefore, I think the negotiating these kinds of terrains, it is not a problem for the locals over here, which is a problem for, troops, because troops, basically, we have troops coming from the plains, we have troops coming from the deserts, and vice versa. In case I've seen Ladakh Scouts troops, people who go to Delhi, people, we have in other parts of the country, they have lots of problems. They may be very fit here, but, when they go down, they are at a point of disadvantage, I would say. So it's a very good idea in case the locals, they're incorporated, and as I've been saying time and again, the infrastructure at the borders, they have to be built up, because we have to keep, everybody, the locals especially, in our folds.
Right.
And that's what I'll say at this point.
So there's one final question I want to ask you, is that a lot of local leaders have said that they have noticed Chinese build up, not just in the past month, but in the past couple of months, in fact, in the last year as well.
Yeah.
So, and they have communicated that to the LAHDC, and they have communicated that to the center, and they are the people who see it as it happens. So do you think that there should be a process of inducting these local voices so that the information percolates faster and our response time can be better? Do you think there's a need to do that?
Definitely. I think in case, people, they are more transparent, because it's a question of, national security. It's a very sensitive issue, and that is why the local concern has to be, taken care of, and we have to have voice. People who speak, people who are concerned, they have to be taken into the folds. And that is why I feel basically, the people out there in the borders, in case you give them voice, how do you do that? You can only do that by developing those places. And in case these people, they are in positions of, influence, they'll be able to come out without any inhibitions. As of now, the borders, they are not developed. You don't have any voice over there. These people, they have been, facing the brunt of the Chinese grazing lands. They are being encroached upon, and these people, they are being threatened, they are being bullied, but there is nobody to speak their minds. So definitely we have to have this sort of a mechanism, and in case we have these kinds of concerns, I think it must be conveyed through proper channels to the top, the government of the day. Otherwise, we will have, problems like these, and nation will not know.
So, finally, what is your final message, if you had to give one to the nation as a Ladakhi who has lived here all his life, you have served in the army, you have served in the Kargil war, to avoid a war-like situation once again, to avoid a ghastly incident like in Galwan Valley? What must we do going forward to avoid such a situation again?
Yeah, we have to, keep our relations with the neighbors in mind. We try and, have everything being taken off and resolved peacefully. That should be our aim. And that means, the government channels and diplomatic channels, they have to be, engagement constantly. And we should try and understand as to what is the aim. What is the aim? But then we should not be the first. That's what the government has been saying. We will not be the first to ingress or take any aggressive action. But then we have to be prepared, because we don't know, what the others, they have in mind. What is their strategy? So from that point of view also, I think it's definitely required. As of now, we understand the strategy of both our adversaries, Pakistan and China both, and especially when both the countries are joining hands. So our security concerns, they increase. That's what I feel. And on the borders, naturally, you know, in keeping with the policy of the government, we have to strengthen our army. You know, we have to have that kind of modern equipment. Technological developments are taking place, and we should try and induct the latest equipment and weapon into the army, and army should be modernized, and thereafter the training also has to be keeping that thing in mind. And we can't slacken our vigil in this case. Definitely not.
Right there, Colonel Wang Chuk, giving us very strong points that we need to strengthen our army. We need to be strong diplomatically in order to avoid such a Galwan Valley-like situation in the future. Thank you so much, Colonel, for joining us on The Print. That's all that we have for you at this moment. This is Shravasti Dasgupta with Sajid Ali Mir reporting in Leh for The Print.